I welcome members to the fourth meeting in 2016 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, and as always ask members to switch off their mobile phones, please. Agenda item one is the opportunity to welcome Lesley Brennan and invite her, in accordance with Section 3 of the Code of Conduct, to declare any relevant interests.
I have no relevant interest to declare.
Thank you very much indeed. Agenda item two is a decision on taking business in private. It's proposed that we take item eight in private. This will allow us to consider the evidence received on the Succession Scotland Bill. Does the committee agree to do so, please?
Yes.
Thank you. Agenda item three is instruments subject to affirmative procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002, designation of persons as Scottish Public Authorities Order 2016 draft, nor the Courts Reform Scotland Act 2014, Consequential Provisions Order 2016 draft, nor the Equality Act 2010, Specific Duties Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016 draft, nor the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions, Scotland Amendment No. 2, Order 2016 draft, nor the Kinship Care Assistance, Scotland Order 2016 draft, nor the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, Modification of Schedules 2 and 3, Order 2016 draft, nor the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978, Independent Clinic Amendment Order 2016 draft, nor the Air Quality Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016 draft, nor the Reservoir Enforcement etc. Scotland Order 2016 draft, nor the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 Part 4 and Part 5 Complaints Order 2016 draft, nor the Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act 2014 Consequential Modifications Order 2016 draft, nor the Public Services Reform Insolvency Scotland Order 2016 draft, nor the Public Services Reform Social Work Complaints Procedure Scotland Order 2016 draft, nor the Letting Agent Code of Practice Scotland Regulations 2016 draft, and finally the Pharmacy Premises Standards Information Obligations etc. Order 2016 draft. Is the committee content with these instruments, please?
Yes.
Agenda item four is instrument subject in negative procedure, and again no points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Sea Fish Prohibited Methods of Fishing Firth of Clyde Order 2016, SSI 2016-12, nor the Public Bodies Joint Workings Prescribed Health Board Functions Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-15, nor the Named Persons Training Qualifications Experience and Position Scotland Order 2016, SSI 2016-16, nor the Children's Plan Scotland Order 2016, SSI 2016-17, nor the Fireworks Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-18, nor the Water Environment Remedial Measures Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-19, nor the National Assistance Sums for Personal Requirements Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-23, nor the Products Containing Meat etc. Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-24, nor the National Assistance Assessment of Resources Amendment Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-25, nor the Healthcare Improvement Scotland Fees Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-26, nor the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007, Prescribed Purposes for Consideration of Suitability Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-27. Is the committee content with these, please?
Yes.
And agenda item five is instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure, and no points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Scottish Parliament Elections Regional Returning Officers and Constituency Returning Officers Order 2016, SSI 2016-9, nor the Serious Crime Act 2015, Commencement No. 1 and Saving Provisions Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-11, nor the Courts Reform Scotland Act 2014, Commencement No. 6 and Transitional Provisions Order 2016, SSI 2016-13, nor the Water Resources Scotland Act 2013, Commencement No. 3 Order 2016, SSI 2016-14, nor the Public Services Reform Scotland Act 2010, Commencement No. 7 Order 2016, SSI 2016-22. Is the committee content with those instruments?
Yes.
Thank you, and I do want to say, on behalf of the committee, a huge word of thanks to our lawyers who have done a vast amount of work to get through those in the last week.
Yeah.
Agenda item six is the Education Scotland Bill. This item is for the committee to consider the delegated power provisions in the bill as amended at stage two. The stage three debate on the bill will take place on Tuesday, the 2nd of February 2016. Therefore, members should agree their conclusions today. Paragraph 3 of the schedule to the bill inserts a new section 3AA into the Educational Additional Support for Learning Scotland Act 2004, which is the 2004 Act. This new section sets out a list of wellbeing factors which are to be taken into account by an educational authority or a tribunal when considering whether a child's wellbeing is adversely affected. These wellbeing factors also appear in section 96 of the Scotland Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, the 2014 Act. New section 3AA3 of the 2004 Act, as inserted by the bill, provides that Scottish ministers may by regulations modify this list of wellbeing factors. A similar power exists in section 96(6) of the 2014 Act. The Supplementary Delegated Powers Memorandum notes that the new power is necessary so as to enable the list of wellbeing factors to be updated in the 2004 Act to meet any amendments made in the list of factors in Section 96 of the 2014 Act. Therefore, the intention is the new power to be consequential on changes to the 2014 Act. The power to amend the list of wellbeing factors in Section 96 of the 2014 Act is subject to the affirmative procedure, whereas the power to be inserted into the 2004 Act by the bill is subject to the negative procedure. For reasons of consistency within the 2014 Act, the committee may consider this power ought also to be subject to the affirmative procedure. Does the committee agree to, one, draw to the attention of the Parliament the power in the new Section 3AA of the 2004 Act as inserted by paragraph 3 of the schedule to the bill, and two, to recommend that the bill is further amended at stage 3 to make this power subject to the affirmative procedure. Stuart.
Thank you very much, convener. Clearly, you used the word that these powers in the 2004 Act and the 2014 Act are similar. It does appear that they go beyond similarity to be actually identical. And while I'm content that we do draw Parliament's attention to the insertion of 3AA in the terms that you've suggested we agree, I think also it's worth noting on the record that perhaps it might have been more satisfactory to simply amend one of the acts to consolidate into a single list so that you always had continuity between what would then be one list rather than two. Certainly, clearly, in having the negative procedure as it's currently drafted for one list and the affirmative for the other, there's a substantial danger that the timescales for implementation would be different, even if the orders were laid on the same day. So aligning them to the same procedure is certainly necessary. But I do think it's slightly remiss that we haven't just taken the opportunity to end up with one list if the intention is the lists are always identical. Convener.
Yeah, indeed. Are we content, therefore, to recommend that we draw those to the committee's attention?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Sorry, to the Parliament's attention. Does the committee also agree that it's content with the remaining delegated powers in the bill, which have been added or substantially amended at stage 2?
Yes.
Thank you. Right, that completes agenda item 6. Agenda item 7 will start once we've got the panel of witnesses in, so I shall briefly suspend this meeting, please. Well, good morning again. Our penultimate agenda item today is oral evidence on the Succession Scotland Bill, and more specifically on the Stage 3 amendments lodged by the government in relation to bondsification. We will take evidence from three panels, firstly from officials, secondly from experts, and lastly from the Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs. Well, I'd like to thank all the witnesses who are attending today, given the very short notice we've been able to provide one way or another. And I would also like to thank Trustbar, who have provided evidence in writing in such a short timescale as well. So panel one, and I welcome Jill Clark, who's the head of Civil Law Reform Unit in Scottish Government, Neil Murgy, who's the solicitor of Scottish Government Legal Directorate, Caroline Drummond, who's Commissioner from the Scottish Law Commission, with Charles Garland, who's Project Manager of the Scottish Law Commission, and Jane MacDonald, who's the Head of Policy and Legislation Branch of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. So good morning to all of you again. I think we'll go straight to questions, which will be led by John Scott.
Thank you, Convener, and again, welcome back to this committee, which is an unexpected pleasure for us and, I dare say, for you too. The first question I have is, what are the circumstances in which it is currently required to obtain a bondification, and how common is it for there to be such a requirement?
Well, maybe I could give a little bit of background around that as well. If no executor is named in a will, and if there's no will, the court will appoint an executor dative, and normally this will be the surviving spouse or civil partner, but if there's no such person, then another person who is eligible to inherit would probably apply. Before obtaining confirmation, an executor dative must find cation for the administration of the estate. So it's for executor dative, and in a very few circumstances, executors nominate. And the bondification is intended to protect the inheritance of beneficiaries and also debts owed to creditors of the estate against the kind of wrongful actions of the executor. And the only exception to this requirement is where the executor dative is the spouse of the deceased and his or her prior rights would use up the whole estate effectively. And there are currently only two providers of bondsification, Zurich and Royal Sun Alliance. And Zurich has taken their business decision to withdraw from the market with effect from the 1st of February, which is next week. And the sole provider, which will be Royal Sun Alliance, they have a requirement that in order to provide a bond, it's conditional on a solicitor being appointed to administer the estate. And Zurich didn't have such a requirement. And so Zurich's decision impacts mainly on small estates who are subject to what's known as the simplified procedure, which currently doesn't require a solicitor. And they will now have the additional burden of appointing a solicitor in order to obtain the necessary bondification. In terms of numbers, I think there was about just short of 4,000 dative petitions in 13-14. We can't break that down into small estates, of course, but I don't know if Jane has got anything to offer on numbers.
I think the most recent number we came up with was around about 800 or so small estates, I think, that that required bondsification.
Okay. I could just take the opportunity of registering for those who might be listening in or reading this. Am I right in thinking an executor nominate is one who is named in the will, and executor dative is someone who is given that power by the court?
Yes.
Okay, I think that might be helpful just to put that bit of Latin on the record. John.
Many thanks for that. Can I just ask you if there are any further implications of Zurich withdrawing provision of bonds of cation in terms of small estates and more generally?
Not that we've considered, no. I mean, the impact is the cost on a small estate of having to bear the cost of the solicitor and the potential delay that it may create as well for the court service.
Thank you. Can you explain to the committee the purpose and effect of the amendments that you've lodged in terms of small estates and how, in your view, they address the problem created by Zurich's decision to withdraw provision of bonds of cation?
Well, there's a series of amendments, and the main one removes the requirement for executors who are administering a small estate subject to the simplified procedure to obtain a bond of cation. And this is by amending the Intestates, Widows and Children's Scotland Act 1875 and the Confirmation of Executors Scotland Act 1823, which removes that requirement. And that's to ensure that estates which currently benefit from a kind of streamlined, supported process to minimise costs and to enable individuals to administer the estate without the need to engage a solicitor can continue to benefit from this facility. And in addition, an amendment is being made to the Confirmation of Scotland, Executors Scotland Act 1823, to ensure that civil partners enjoy the same exemption from the requirement to hold, to obtain a bond of cation where they are the executor dative, and through prior rights they would inherit the whole estate as well. So that's putting them on a par with the current law as it relates to spouses. And then we've also lodged amendments to give ministers a range of powers by way of future proofing against any further changes in the cation market.
Okay, thank you very much. Can you explain to the committee the purpose and effect of the amendments you've lodged in terms of small estates? I think you probably have, and how, in your view, they address the problems created by... I think I just asked that question, didn't I? Going on to... Can you explain which small estates are eligible for the small estate procedure and therefore will be affected by the proposed exemption? And can you explain the process by which small estates which are not suitable for the procedure are identified and removed?
I could start that answer and then perhaps Jane will help out a bit. I mean, just now, if a small estate is classed as under the gross value of the estate, which is subject to confirmation or to be confirmed to, is under £36,000. And the ones that qualify for the simplified procedure are the ones where there would be no competition for the office of executor, or where there's no question around the validity of the will or what's contained in the will. Is the will formed correctly? Where the deceased died in Scotland, so not if they didn't die in Scotland. So there's a kind of mechanism to filter out estates that might be more contentious, and they can't use the simplified procedure. Jane, do you want to add to that?
Yes, the Sheriff Clerk, who has authority to administer the small estates without reverting to any judicial consideration of it, deals with it has to be the simple estate. So it has to be the ones that the information is clearly laid out in a form. There's no looking any deeper into the information on the form. We accept it at face value, and so it's the factual listing of details. And then it's in estates where there's very simple listing of contents of in the inventory, for example, in if there's any inclusion of titles to land or anything of that sort, we would say that they may wish to seek advice of a solicitor in these kind of estates, or if there's any complication in the line to succession, so it's not a simple working through the Succession Scotland Act 64, which lays out a clear line succession. If there's anything difficult there, we would suggest that wasn't suitable for a small estate procedure, and we'd ask them to go through the large estate procedure, which would bring it in front of a sheriff.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Can I just extend that again? Forgive me, just going back. Who is it, if there's no executor, who is it who draws up the inventory? Who is it who gets a gross valuation? How does the process start, please?
We ask the person who thinks they're entitled to be an executor. They usually phone up the various financial institutions who hold the money, the bank or whatever, and they get the sum of money in the account, the account numbers, and they actually have to bring that to us. So they have to get that before we can confirm them to the estate. So it is a kind of they have to get some information without being an executor before they can actually apply to have that confirmed fully.
Yeah, that sounds actually enormously complicated. Forgive me, it's not what's in front of us, but if you're not already an executor, then how do you even have authority to ask the bank for the balance of the account for somebody else? I'm sorry, I don't think that affects the legalities of this, but I'm trying to get back to who it is who starts the whole process before they get anywhere near an executor being...
I simply don't know that. The answer to that in a small estate, all I know is that family members are able to turn up at the court with that information, and they've obviously managed to get it from their banks, or from the banks of the family member. It's usually a father or a brother, and they've been able to satisfy the bank that they're the person who at least has an entitlement to the estate, right, even though they've not been confirmed.
Thank you. I may be going back further than we need to, Stuart.
I just wonder if it would be useful to get confirmation that it is the general practice of registrars, who will of course register the death, to hand the person registering the death a leaflet which will introduce the person registering the death to the activities they now should be considering undertaking. And that's probably the starting point. Is that understanding I've stated one that I'm seeing nodding in the public gallery, so I suspect I'm correct.
The substance of what we have here today. Stuart, I think you want to carry on with the questions as...
Indeed. And just to perhaps get on the record, clearly in talking about bondsification here, we're talking about a particular kind of insurance. And I just wondered if it might be useful to say what attributes does this insurance policy have to have that make it a valid bondification under the law?
In terms of insurance, my understanding, it's more of a guarantee. It's a guarantee against the actions of the executor and a means of protecting the beneficiaries and creditors. But... Jane, are you able to offer anything on that?
Not particularly. I'm afraid it's a fairly simple bond. I have an example here, which I could pass around, but it's fairly tied up in legal phraseology. But it is a fairly simple bond that's just covers the executor in insurance. Would you be interested to pass it around?
Well, possibly. That might be useful. So therefore, if it's a bond, there is presumably a limit to the cover that's provided. There's a value associated with a bond.
That's right. The amount of the bond covers full amount of the confirmation in the estate.
Right.
And
that's okay.
What we'd be looking for.
I suppose the questions around this subject are who in essence is paying out, and who is liable ultimately to the beneficiaries. Is the existence of the bondification makes the primary liability to beneficiaries under circumstances of fraud, negligence or maladministration is the company or person who has issued the bond. Is that correct?
The executor really remains liable. And indeed, a beneficiary should pursue the executor first to get any loss back. And the bond is there to pick up the pieces should that not be possible, because perhaps the executor is bankrupt or doesn't have the means to meet that claim.
So is that suggesting, therefore, that bondification is actually a protection for the executor rather than a protection for the beneficiaries?
It's intended as a protection for the beneficiaries and also creditors to the estate to ensure that they are paid out of any money that the state has. The estate may not have sufficient to meet its debts, but...
Indeed. So therefore, it is really, ultimately, it's the beneficiaries who benefit from the bondification process, or hopefully don't, of course.
Yes.
It would be the case. Now, in order to recover what they might have been due under the distribution of the estate had it not been subject to fraud, negligence or maladministration, there may be a legal process that the beneficiary might have to undertake. Is that beneficiary Under what circumstances, perhaps, is that beneficiary able to access civil legal aid to progress that claim?
It would depend on whether the beneficiary is eligible for legal aid, civil legal aid. So civil legal aid is available. It could be available for advice and assistance, or then full legal aid, one or other or both. It may be partial. They may have to make a contribution towards it depending on their income. So if they qualified for it, they would obtain legal aid. If the claim was a small claim, so it was under £3,000, that system is designed not to require a solicitor, and it's a claim that they could raise themselves, and legal aid wouldn't be payable for a small claim because it doesn't require the solicitor.
So any costs that are initially borne by the beneficiary in pursuing their legal claim, if proved, are they ultimately costs for the estate?
No. I'm saying no. That isn't my understanding. My understanding is that the bond wouldn't cover the beneficiary's legal costs.
If you're raising a civil action, quite often what you'd ask for is the money that you were due and the expenses of raising the action, and that would be part of the action you raised. That is the fairly standard procedure within in a court if you're raising an action to reclaim a debt, and this would be just considered in the same way as any action to reclaim a debt.
So therefore, the estate itself, provided the claim is constructed appropriately, would bear the costs of pursuing?
Yes,
yes.
If that's what the court allowed, yes.
Sorry, Convener, I'm just checking. I've covered.
No, it's okay. We're all. John.
And therefore, in the absence of there being sufficient funds in the estate, ultimately the bond of obligation would pick up
the short
costs,
yeah, yeah,
for someone having to pursue their entitlements through the court.
That's what I had.
Well, it would guarantee the loss of the estate.
Not necessarily, no.
Can I ask how often these actions actually happen? I mean, I appreciate the law says you have to have a bondification, therefore everybody's going to have one, but how often does it actually come down to?
Our understanding is very rarely.
Right.
I think the Scottish Law Commission found the same when they...
Has anybody got any data at all, or even if it's historical, on how often these things actually happen, the implications are?
I mean, I spoke to Royal Sun Alliance earlier this week, and they felt that was commercial data that they couldn't provide.
Okay.
I think it would be fair to suggest, perhaps you might agree, disagree, or decline to comment, that given... If, as you suggest, there might be 800 estates where this would apply, and that we understand the average cost is around £150 or thereby, and therefore the total income per annum for the insurance company is £120,000, that therefore the claims that they might pay out, if they're still in the market at all, must be substantially less than that. And the average claim is likely to be more than the cost of the bond occasion. We can begin to see that the numbers must inevitably, just for the commercial operation of this, be pretty small indeed. Right, I'm getting nodding heads, so nobody's picking up on a flaw on my comment. Right, the final thing, it might be just useful on this subject to cover. I made reference to the leaflet that is passed out to people when they register deaths, which... for small estates in particular, is likely to be the starting point of a process. Are you aware of whether that leaflet might be updated in the light of the changes we're now contemplating to the law? Or in fact, is that probably not necessary because we're actually merely protecting the existing process by the changes we're making?
The leaflet isn't due a significant overhaul because we're waiting for any subsequent legislation, but I mean we do update it through addendums and inserts, and we can certainly do that, and we would keep our website, which has guidance on it, up to date as well. But It's probably, as you say, not essential.
Scottish Court Service website, and that will be updated depending on the decisions that are made about the bondification. So we have guidance.
I did ask about the lawyer.
Thank you. Okay, does John Mason want to take over at this point? Thank you.
Convener. I mean, on the surface of it, there's not a huge number of amendments here, and yet I think three times we have the phrase the Scottish Ministers may by regulations, so there's quite a lot of delegated powers in here. And I just wondered if you could explain why that's been necessary. Has it been time pressure, or would that is it really that's what we believe the way it should be handled?
Well, I think we're acting responsibly to try and future-proof. We only had two providers of bondification, which wasn't ideal. We're down to one, and that's very undesirable. And whilst Royal Sun Alliance have assured us that they've no desire to stop providing bondification, we can't say unequivocally that will never happen now. I think we're far warier, and their business model may change as well. So what we're trying to do with the powers is look ahead and say, well, if we were left with no cationers, do we want to be in the position that we're in right at this time, where we're having to react very quickly to a change in the market? So these powers would enable new cases to be created in which cation is not required to be found. They would enable the requirement for bonds of cation to be completely abolished. And they also enable the setting of conditions around things that would have to be met before an executor dative could be appointed. And that could be for all executor datives or just certain types of executor datives. And we could apply different processes to different types of executor datives as well. So they're all there to reflect that the market may change in the future, and that we need to be ready to respond in an effective way, and not a kind of knee-jerk reaction, and that provides that, because otherwise we would have to bring forward emergency legislation potentially now, and then emergency legislation again, and that wouldn't be desirable either.
No, not ideal. I mean, I do understand that. I mean, would it have been possible to put a bit more in the bill, for example, the executive dative, like who would be excluded? Could that have been detailed in more on the face of the bill?
I suppose going back to the reason that this bill was supposed to be the vehicle for abolishing bondification, and it's not. And it's not because of the response that we got to the consultation, where people agreed that cation should be abolished, but then there was not a lot of consensus around what alternate safeguards might look like. Not everyone agreed that judicial discretion was the only answer. People felt there should be other things, and that combination of safeguards wasn't clear, which is why we've consulted again. So I think what we're trying to do is target who we think is affected now by Zurich's decision, which is the small estate, and deal with that, and then take powers that would enable us to either react in the future to there being no cationers, or to take forward the reform of bondification once we've had the opportunity to analyse the second set of responses to the second consultation about the matter and see if things are clearer. So there's kind of two options there.
Okay, fair enough. I mean, were there any other options apart from legislation at all? I mean, was anything else considered, or was it just felt it has to be legislation?
Well, I think there's do nothing. It's always the first option, and for the reasons we've set out, we didn't think that was tenable. The Scottish Court Service had already spoken with Zurich about their, I suppose, ability to delay their decision or be flexible about their decision, but there wasn't any flexibility around that. So those kind of options weren't really going anywhere.
I mean, if we had waited, or if we did wait until, well, the next session of Parliament, say, and legislated then, do you think that would have caused a problem?
Yes, I think it would cause a problem in terms of the expense that it would put some people to that they don't currently have to you know, pay for solicitors' fees. And, you know, some people might have been reluctant to wind up their estate for that reason, and that would have had quite a significant impact on the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service, which Jane may be able to speak about a little more.
I think our main concern is that you'd be asking the court to grant confirmation in small estates, which was simply not possible because the law requires them to have a bondification, so we'd be unable to operate the small estate procedure. And I think it's the impact on the people of where the small estate is under 36,000. And I have to say that at least a quarter of these in the last year were under 15,000. Some are only for 4,000 or 5,000. It's people with one bank account who don't have anything much else, but the bank won't release the money to them if it's a brother or a sister or an aunt or an uncle. So they need the confirmation. So our concern initially really was to do with the impact on these people who would then have to go and seek legal advice, which they would have to pay for, which was unnecessary in the simplicity of the of winding up their relative's estate. And then the knock-on effect from that is that if all these people cannot confirm their estates, apart from not being able even maybe to meet funeral expenses, if they can't claim the money from the estate, that there'd be a backlog of work that it would take us some time to work through. But our principal concern is about the impact on the people who might otherwise be able to administer their small estate and wind up their relative's estate.
Okay, fair enough. I mean, I just wondered, we were told in one of our briefing papers that bondification is usually provided by an insurance company. I mean, can anyone or does anyone else provide bondification?
I'm going to probably refer to Jane again, but yes, you can get privatcation. So, you know, someone who was willing to guarantee the value of an estate. Charles Wickey, yes.
I wonder if could do no more perhaps than read out of a book whose author will be appearing before you shortly. The position appears to be that private individuals were formally permitted to be cationers, but in practice now only persons authorised to carry on a regulated investment activity under a piece of legislation can be cationers, which effectively means it's insurance companies,
yes,
and that is now or will shortly be limited to one.
Yep.
So it wouldn't even be possible for the public sector or anything to step in and do that because they wouldn't fulfil that requirement?
There would need to be from this information, there would need to be a regulatory requirement and probably a fairly onerous one met,
right, okay,
if this was the sole purpose of the public sector involvement.
Something that small becomes a regulated financial transaction, but that's where we've got to.
Indeed, and the as I understand it, the continuing provider insurance company, through their requirement that there be a solicitor instructed, means that regardless of the size of the estate, there will need to be a solicitor, which not only adds to the cost for the estate, but it also seems to me further insulates the company from any claim because you've got the executor who's the first line, as it were, but then there's also a solicitor, and if there's any negligence or whatever, that's automatically covered by the indemnity policy, and then you've got to get through those two hurdles before there's any possible claim on the cationer.
Indeed, that looks like rather clever insurance breaking, actually. Stuart?
Is it not the case, in fact, that solicitors would in any event be covered for the defalcations by the professional body of which they are members? So therefore, you're almost left in the position that the issuer of the bondification has all but no liability and is merely raking in the money because of a quirk in the law. And I'm getting nodding heads at the other end of the table, convener.
Thank you very much for that intervention. Can I say it's actually wonderful to see you reading from a book. It's lovely to know that you don't have to be dead before you're an authority. Right, on that happy note, can I take us to Lesley Brennan, who I think wants to take us to the next bit, please.
Thank you. The Scottish Government previously indicated that it would not be pursuing matters in relation to bonds of cation. In the context of this bill, can you now set out for the committee why you took the decision and why you now feel compelled to seek to amend this bill in this way.
Yes, what we set out was that, I suppose, take a step back, that in the 2009 report, the Scottish Law Commission recommended that bonds of cation in their entirety for anybody who needed a bond of cation should be abolished. And we consulted on that basis as part of the consultation for this bill. And as I mentioned just a little bit earlier, whilst there was consensus that bonds of cation should be abolished, there wasn't any clarity or consensus around what additional safeguards might be needed to be put in place. People thought that there should be something. Some were very light touch and some were becoming, I'd have said, a lot more burdensome than a bond of cation. And so we needed to consult again on what that might look like, which was why we decided not to take this forward in this bill. In the interim, we've had an unexpected decision from Zurich, and what we've tried to do is just say, well, what is the immediate impact of that? It impacts on small estates, as Jane's very ably described, and we wanted to remedy that. And so we're making quite a targeted and narrow amendment to deal with that, and we're not actually addressing the bigger reform of bonds of cation at this time. We still want to take our time to do that.
Okay, so that sort of helpfully leads me on to the next question. Do you intend to return to consider bonds of cation further in the context of the subsequent succession bill?
Yes, as I say, that was included in the second consultation that we did. That consultation responses are just in the process of being finally analysed. There'll be a report and that will be coming out soon, and that's when we'll turn our mind to what we do on bonds of cation. And potentially we have two options now. We have, if there's another bill, or we have regulation making powers if these were agreed.
Can you just maybe just give more detail about the consultation that you undertook to inform your decision?
Yes. We consulted on the kind of two things that the commission had recommended. One was that bonds of cation be abolished. The second was that there should be judicial discretion to not appoint an executor dative, because there isn't that discretion at the moment. And as I say, there was a mixed response on whether the Commission solution was that the judicial discretion would provide the safeguard. So would that be fair to say? But we got a mixed response on that, as to whether that in itself was sufficient. And then equally, there was concerns raised about judicial discretion insofar as it changed what is just now quite an administrative process, which can be contained in the way that Jane has described, to one that becomes a judicial process, and then there's sheriffs involved, and there's costs involved in that as well, and time and resource, and that's an impact. So we were looking around the other suggestions that people made in terms of what safeguards might be put in place, such as the kind of due diligence part of an executor dative, that they were fit, you know, fit for purpose, that they understood their role, that they could produce a kind of scheme of distribution or a family tree. And these are the kind of requirements that the cationers place on executor's dative at the moment. So they make them go through kind of an extensive gathering of information before the cation is agreed. So it was all around that. And then we've taken that one step further in the next consultation to say, well, what would these safeguards look like?
Okay, thank you. So,
are similar requirements in existence for executives nominative?
I'll defer to any other colleague to say the circumstances in which an executor nominate requires a bond of cation. But yes, the same would apply, because it's a bond of cation.
Sorry, before you answer that, perhaps I was actually pursuing a slightly different point, that you were in essence telling the committee that executives' data had to demonstrate an understanding of what they were doing and so on and so forth. And I was merely seeking to see, slightly independently of the issue of bondification, whether executives nominate similarly had to demonstrate.
Only if they're getting a bondification, because my understanding is it's the cationers who require these steps to be followed. So if they were an executor nominee who didn't need a bondification, they would presumably just have to do the normal stuff in terms of winding up the estate.
So an executor nominate is purely somebody who is legally capable. In other words, they're not legally incapable. That's it.
They may or they may not be.
No, I'm meaning when I say that, they have the mental faculties of a normal person. This is perhaps not the right place to pursue this issue because it is tangential to the main subject, convener.
Because I am going to come on to it actually here. Thank you, Stuart. Can I just actually pick up on what that might have meant and what certainly I'm hoping it meant? Are there any rules at the moment on what a sheriff can do to disallow someone who is an executor nominate but who appears to the outside world to be a bad choice? Or are they, in fact, not only nominate but actually entitled to proceed?
Well, I mean, again, I'm looking at Jane, but yes, I mean, somebody might have been, you know, nominated in a will, but they've since lost capacity, so
yes,
it wouldn't be appropriate that they went on to, they wouldn't be capable of.
Right,
of
but is that a court? Does the court decide that?
In these cases, if there was a suggestion made at all to us that the person named in a will was incapax, then we'd suggest that an application be made then to the sheriff, and that would almost invariably be solicitors. That would never happen without a solicitor being involved, and most often it's alerted to us always by a solicitor making an application to a court to have somebody else either taken from the body of the will, who's not actually the named person because they're deemed not to be.
So the court has a common law right to supplant the executor nominate if there's good reason for doing so. If I'm making up the words, but does that sound roughly right?
I couldn't tell you if it was common law or not, I'm afraid, off the top of my head, and it would only be on the application of a party. They wouldn't do it of their own accord. They would have to be, somebody would have to apply to replace that person in a will.
Who would have to have an interest in the will?
Yes.
I wonder if I could add
a couple of
words to that. I think putting it very crudely, the position is that for an executor nominate, somebody named in a will, there is essentially no requirement to obtain bondification, that there are some old cases where this has been found, but essentially not. And essentially, the court has no power to refuse to appoint the person. Obviously, if the person lacks capacity, then they can't put themselves forward to the court to be appointed. So it may be that there is a different way of cracking that nut. But if they're capable and willing, then, as I understand it, the court has no power to refuse on the basis that they have been chosen by the testator.
Yes, indeed. Okay. Could I then move on, colleagues, to ask what the government sees as the protections against fraud under the circumstances that what we have before us is agreed by the Parliament? What steps are you proposing, please?
I have to say that it's probably not possible to remove all risk of fraud. The approach we've taken is to limit the exceptions from the requirement to find cation to estates which currently benefit from the small estate special procedure and the extension of the spousal exemption to civil partners. But we are also seeking a range of powers which offer flexibility to ensure that, if necessary, we're in a position to restrict the exemptions by, for example, requiring further information. In terms of any losses suffered, a beneficiary will continue to have recourse to sue the executor as they have now. And indeed, even now, there's an expectation that a beneficiary would initially try to claim against the executor. The protection that will be removed is that they will no longer have recourse to an insurance fund if there's little or no prospect of recovery from the executor. And that's why the amendments are targeted at the specific and narrow group of small estates. A separate case has already been made for these small estates in one way because they qualify for the simplified procedure. They're therefore already treated differently. And there is already a filtering mechanism in the court, which means that if a small estate is contentious, then it doesn't qualify for the simplified procedure. And again, already in some small estates, fund holders pay out without the need for confirmation. And our understanding is that's not problematic. And so we think this approach balances the risk to beneficiaries against the certainty of having to pay legal fees on all, for all of these estates, which are likely to be a drain on the estate.
Yes, okay, that does make sense. Thank you. Could I then move to the amendments to give the government powers to change things in the future, which again, we understand. There's a list within here of possible conditions, although they're put in the generality. I'm also conscious that we've received some advice from Trust Bar, which I'm rather hoping the government has seen. Is that fair comment?
We have seen it.
You have seen it, right. I wouldn't upon you. Clearly they're using slightly different words, and I'm not commending theirs in particular, other than it comes from Trust Bar and we're grateful for them. Can you respond to the idea that as to which particular conditions ought to be met, or whether the generality of what's in the regulation as drafted is the best way to do it, or whether we should be looking for you to put some of the more detail in this, perhaps by amendment?
Well, I think we're really trying to have kind of quite responsive and flexible powers, which is why they're probably drafted in these terms. But the conditions that might be included, around the court being satisfied that the person is suitable for appointment, or that the court is to be provided with particular information about the person seeking appointment or about the estate. So it's those sorts of conditions. Or they have to produce certain material before the court can grant confirmation. Do you want to say anything about the powers, Neil? Or not really?
Yeah, I mean, the powers have been taken in respect of the suitability kind of divide into two parts, one where the court can look at the suitability of the individual, and which is more along the lines of judicial discretion, and a more kind of administrative process where they can consider certain pieces of information, tick box information that's needed before they can accept the person as executor dative.
I think what concerns us as a committee is whether at this stage there's the right balance between the generality of trying to solve every possible problem and the specificity of solving the problem that's in front of us, and trying quite simply not to give the government too wide a discretion to do things that Parliament will always jealously guard. I don't think what I'm looking at actually suggests to me the government is doing anything unreasonable, but I wanted to test whether you felt any of the other comments that had come at least suggested that you should be doing something differently.
No, is the short answer. And I mean, the regulations are subject to the affirmative procedure as well,
yes,
which would mean we would come back and respond to any.
Yeah. Can I just ask whether you've considered the possibility of actually, even within a smaller state, giving the court the option of requiring a bondification? I know we're trying to abolish them, but actually requiring a trustee, maybe an executive, pardon me, maybe to have to find some kind of bondification in order to be appointed. Is that a discretion which the court should perhaps have, at least for the time being?
I think that brings us back into all the difficulties around a discretion.
Yeah.
And how it's exercised and who would exercise it and what, you know, things that they might consider in the exercise of it. And if that was done particularly at a judicial level, because I think at an administrative level be felt that that wasn't appropriate, mm-hmm. then there are also resource implications and cost implications of that, which we think would be disproportionate to what we're doing here.
Yeah. So on balance, the proposal is that we do, albeit perhaps very small, very lightly, increase the risk of fraud and maladministration, but in the process we take out a huge amount of complexity and cost in the system, and on balance that would seem to be a reasonable thing to do.
Yes.
Yep, okay, thank you. Right, I think that brings us to the end of the issues that we had thought we need to discuss. My colleagues seem to imply that that's the case. Because this is an expedited process, I really just want to make sure that everybody feels they've had their say. Ladies and gentlemen, is there anything else that you feel you wanted to put on the record? We've just failed to ask you the right question. No, that's always encouraging, right, for as much as no one speaks. I think, John, please.
Given the expedited process of which Convener speaks, and our very much limited timescale of considering the expert advice that you and others will be providing, would you reserve the option to reconsider any of this area of law in terms of bonification in the next in the succession bill or not?
In terms of it is for consideration in the next bill, yes, and we would certainly look at the experience of the impact of this change, and if it's not as we anticipate, then there's obviously an opportunity to remedy that, but we would hope we wouldn't have to.
Quite. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. In which case, thank you very much for your evidence, and I'll briefly suspend to enable the panel to change. Right, resuming. Thank you very much indeed. It's my pleasure to welcome our panel of experts, who are John Kerrigan, who's a partner with Morrison's LLP and a member of the Law Society of Scotland, Ellie Scobie, who's a private client partner of Burnett and Reid LLP, and Dr. Dot Reid, who's senior lecturer in private law at the University of Glasgow. Can I say thank you very much for coming, in some cases some considerable distance through some pretty foul weather, and also to listening to the panel beforehand, so I think you're very well informed about what's going on. And our questioning will be led again by John Scott.
Thank you, Convener. And again, I add my thanks to you for making such an effort to come here to help us today and at such short notice. First question is how common is it for there to be a requirement to obtain a bond of cation? In particular, how common is it in relation to small estates?
My thought about cases where there's bonds of cation is not just the number, but actually most of them are where people die suddenly, often in an accident. So you've got families that are upset extremely by the suddenness of what's happened and are faced with the anxiety that comes from the additional paperwork. Needing a bond of cation adds to the challenges in getting confirmation. So I would say, as well as the number, which is probably not an enormous number, it's actually the impact on the families that are affected. I don't know whether anybody would be in a position to make more comment on the numbers. I thought what we got from the Scottish courts side was helpful and probably reflective. And I would also say that it's not necessarily small estates. I've got one just now where it's about a £3 million estate, and the cost of the bond of cation is considerably greater than the £160.
In terms of a percentage of estates that are settled, is it sort of less than 1% or is it 10%?
Somewhere between 5 and 10% that solicitors see, but it perhaps depends a little bit where they are and what kind of practice area they've got. Of course, the really small ones go straight to the Scottish courts, and if they came to us, we would usually send them straight to the Sheriff Clerk to help.
Okay, does anyone else have anything to say on that question or not? Not. What are the implications of Zurich withdrawing provision of bonds of cation in terms of small estates and more generally? Just want you to put it on the record.
I think it's never good to have only two providers in the first place. When you're left with one monopoly provider, if they take fright, Zurich, there were problems with Zurich because they were asking solicitors who were winding up intestate estates to sign undertakings to Zurich that they would do certain things which were actually leaving solicitors wide open to personal liability. Sunderlines don't do that, but they do insist that where someone wants a bond of cation from them, they have to have a solicitor. If Sunderlines saw that they were more at risk now because they are the only provider, they might start to adopt the position that Zurich were adopting, and that was trying to get the solicitors who were winding up the estates to further underwrite the risk.
So that certainly wouldn't be a beneficial effect and would ultimately lead to more cost to the estates.
Yes.
Can also imagine the Law Society might have something to say about that as well.
The Law Society had concerns, but we're waiting to see what was happening here, if you like, before becoming involved, because what the Law Society didn't want to do was to cause a situation where Zurich might just say, well, if you've got concerns, we'll withdraw. We won't be bothered doing this anymore. We're doing you a favour. They weren't actually, in my view, but I'm speaking personally when I say that. But Zurich changed the whole ballgame by themselves, saying they were withdrawing not only from executories, but also financial guardianships, which concerns me, although I know it's not an issue before this committee.
So do you see it as a very real threat, real rather than imagined, or a real threat that Sun Alliance, Royal Sun Alliance might also say, do you know what?
I would be guessing, but I have to say that my firm has always used Royal and Sun Alliance for bondsification, and we've never had a particular problem with them. If a tricky estate arose, then I or one of my colleagues would ask for a meeting with Royal and Sun Alliance, and we were invariably able to thrash it out, and we were not asked to grant the type of undertaking which Zurich were starting to ask from solicitors winding up estates.
I see.
I mean, if you want my personal view on bondsification, which is perhaps your next question, I'm probably one of those who caused confusion by responding as an individual to the first consultation document when I said that I was concerned that total abolition might leave certain estates vulnerable, and therefore I would prefer a sheriff to have a discretion as to whether or not a bondification was required, coupled with the right to say, I'm not appointing you as executive dative because you are on grounds shown to me not a fit and proper person. Now, that's somebody from my background, a practitioner and possibly semi-academic speaking. I must confess that was not a view that took into account the economic costs to the legal system of these amendments, which I accept are valid considerations.
Given your practical disposition, and given the real risk apparently that there may be no providers left were that to happen, who would you suggest, given you, the need you've outlined for there to be providers, who would you suggest could be providers?
There could be a government scheme. There could be a government scheme. I know you don't want to hear that either. Well,
can I be clear that we are, you know, we are looking for your evidence, please, colleagues. Yes. You know, don't worry about what we want to hear. Okay. Please tell us the way you see it.
In relation to financial guardianships, I think it was fair to say that the public guardian, Sandra MacDonald, had concerns that there were only two providers, Zurich and Royal and Sun Alliance. And I think that she did suggest that if problems arose with either or both of these providers, there could be a government scheme. Now, I accept entirely what Charles said, that privatisation is no longer available because of the regulatory system. But I'm sure the government could have a system regulated. And the question there would be, what would be the cost of that scheme? Royal and Sun Alliance, I asked them the same question. What is the history of claims against bondsification? And the person to whom I spoke said, hardly any. They were very relaxed. Now, I haven't done any empirical research as to the history of claims against financial guardianships. It's an area of law which is burgeoning for all private client practitioners. Courts are now setting up dedicated incapacity courts to deal with financial guardianship and intervention order work. And I think it's not beyond the bounds of possibility that if the sole provider indicated that they were going to withdraw from the market, the government's faced with either you have no bondification or the government does something, and that would be a government-backed scheme.
Your comments about guardianship, financial guardianship, very much appreciated, but I don't think they're actually relevant to precisely what we're talking about now. We do need to be careful to make sure we stick with the bill before us. But it was it's an interesting comment, and obviously anything that's parallel is fair comment. John?
Yes, you said just now that you felt the government might have either the power or the willingness or the ability to step in. Could you clarify if you mean UK government or Scottish government? Would the Scottish government have the power to do that?
Well, Scottish government, bondsification are not required in England.
Yes, but I'm thinking, given the evidence we're given earlier, that it would have to be somebody who was financially regulated.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if that would include the Scottish government or not.
I don't know the answer to that.
No, okay, fair enough.
Okay, yeah, thank you. It's a fair question, which is you're not the only one who thought of it, but I don't think that's a question for here, Stuart.
But given the Oh, sorry. Beg your pardon.
Oh, sorry, I think Stuart wanted... Is that relevant?
Yes, I wanted just to probe. Essentially, where a lawyer is operating, they will be covered by professional indemnity.
Yes.
And to be blunt, is it fair to suggest that if the law said nothing about matters of bonds of cation, that the safeguard would actually be the professional indemnity of the lawyer? It's only because of the history of the law that we've got the, because it's essentially there to protect against the lawyers getting things wrong, is it not?
Lawyers have to act under the instructions of their clients. You can advise a client to follow a particular course. The client may not follow that course. Mm-hmm. And if the client says, you are no longer my lawyer, I dismiss you, please send me the whole funds that you're holding to the order of the estate, the lawyer, I think, has to accept those instructions. So there would be no professional negligence involved there. If that executor then went off and wholly ignored all the advice from the lawyer as to who was entitled to this estate, I don't think there's much the lawyer could do about that.
I think one of the areas where Joe Public, if they think about bonds of cation, imagines that there is a benefit, is that it protects beneficiaries who are in law entitled because of their relationship with the deceased from the money disappearing into the pockets of someone else. Now, my experience thus far is not great with bonds of cation, but in actual claiming on it. But it does seem that when you make that claim, they say, but you filled in the family tree without mentioning the illegitimate child of the deceased uncle. You're stuffed because it was a high faith claim, well, document that you were making when you signed the insurance proposal, and therefore you failed on it, and therefore it's not appropriate that we, the insurance company, pay out. So that's a practical problem with it. That there, although I would have said that I was relatively experienced these days in handling clients and trying to get information out of them, there can be problems where they say, oh, but they've been ill for 20 years, they must be dead by now, which is a fair supposition, but the health service keeps them alive, or they didn't know about the illegitimate child of uncle such and such, genuinely, because often it's relationships that you're going back a couple of generations. So these cases probably aren't protected anyway because they weren't known about unless you put the air searcher onto the job. And therefore, it's slightly illusory what the protection is.
Okay. Right, John? Yeah,
going back to the generalities of bonds of cation, you said that they don't exist in England, Wales. Is there a consequence of that? Is there a reaction to that? Self-evident, there's a difference between the two legal systems.
Yeah.
But do those who'd otherwise should have been beneficiaries, is there an increased number of those who lose out, shall we say?
I can't answer that, Mr. Scott, because I'm not an expert in English estates. An English intestate estate, you obtain letters of administration from the probate court. I don't know what information you have to give to an English probate court to get letters of administration. You certainly don't have to give a family tree to a Scottish commissary court, which is the equivalent of the probate court, to have an executor dative appointed.
So were a situation to arise where there were no providers of bonds of cation here in Scotland, would there be lessons to be learned, or models to be learned from or copied even from the English situation that you would suggest to us?
There might well be, but I'm not qualified to comment on that.
Others?
I wonder if I might say something in my response to the consultation on this. One of the suggestions that I made was that there be, as well as an inventory, which is what's currently required, which is the valuation of the estate, in effect. That's all that's required in order for an executor to be appointed. If at that stage in a simple estate, if a statement of distribution was also included, I don't think it would be that complicated. And that would be an additional safeguard. I mean, just stepping back a little bit, one of the astonishing things about succession is that nobody checks. Nobody checks who gets what. And actually the whole rationale for bonds of cation are that it's an insurance against the wrong people getting the wrong amounts. But actually, in most cases, in most families, this is going to be quite straightforward in an intestate estate. If there's a spouse or civil partner, they will take the whole estate, almost certainly. If there are children or grandchildren, they'll take the whole estate. So there are probably a fairly small number of estates where the distribution is complicated, or relatives have to be searched for, or there's an illegitimate child. These are very much the exception in small estates, that if the executor were to take the inventory of the estate and also a statement of distribution that says this will be divided among the children, then the court can see that actually everybody knows what they're doing here, the right amounts will go to the right people. I think sometimes, anecdotally, succession law is very murky. I think members of the public are not well educated about their succession rights, despite it being on the Scottish Court's website and the government website. But, you know, anecdotally, families sometimes think that it's up to them to randomly distribute the property of the deceased as they see fit, especially if it's a small estate, or it might be the first person who gets to the house. So there are all sorts of things going on in succession law under the radar, I think, that it doesn't seem to me to be a complicated process to have the sheriff clerk look at the inventory and look at who it's going to. In most cases, I think that would be straightforward.
Right. Thank you, Aniko. Yes.
It might also be helpful in the same sort of line as that, is having in the commissary papers that the applicant gets is something telling them that misinformation in this will be treated by the sheriff as very serious, because it hints at fraud, and there's some cases where there's a hint of contempt of court. I'm not sure that a sheriff would actually take that approach, but...
I think I agree in principle with what Dr. Reid said. The only point I would make there is you would surely require a solicitor to draw up the statement of division, which is taking us back to the stage where people in a small estate might require to instruct a solicitor.
I'm not sure you would. I don't think it's rocket science. Hmm. I think that if the sheriff clerk is already involved in this process, it's not unimaginable that the sheriff clerk could be trained to know within a family tree how an intestate estate is divided. I don't think it's that complicated.
Or a little computer model.
Changes the
figures as required.
Is the sheriff clerk going to ask, however, for a family tree prepared by a genealogist then?
I mean, in most cases, yeah. the close family will be known.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yes,
I'm in here.
Convener.
Can I just ask a layman's question?
Do forgive me. Very naive. Does the inventory cover both movable and fixed assets? I just wanted to be clear about that. Thank you.
Right. John, I think we're working with you.
I think I should just go to the final question that I have for you, which is... can you explain to the committee your understanding of the purpose and effect of the amendments that the government has lodged, and whether, in your view, they address the problem created by Zurich's decision to withdraw provision of bonds of occasion? Do you think there are any other routes the Scottish government could have pursued? I guess we've kind of skirted round about that, but if you'd like to put your response to that specific question on the record, please, that'd be really helpful.
Well, I think I would just repeat what I said previously, that I think there is an alternative for the majority of cases that could use the existing sheriff clerk involvement. And given the small number of claims that are made on bonds of cation, that it that may solve the vast majority of problems.
Excellent, thank you.
I agree with what the Scottish Government have proposed, because I think there is an immediate problem caused by the withdrawal of Zurich, and I appreciate this is a quick fix, but I think it's a very fair quick fix, and I support it on the basis that, again, it's my understanding that more fundamental questions as to bonds of cation across the board and whether or not sheriffs should be given the right to say, I'm not appointing a particular individual, which they don't have at the moment. As long as you qualify as a beneficiary in the estate, the sheriff has to appoint you. And that means you get some very unprepossessing people appointed as executors dative. I mean, the classic example, I've had this on more than one occasion. A client comes to you and says, I need your help. Our mother died 4 months ago. There's me and my older brother and my younger brother. Older brother was quick off the mark, got to a solicitor, has had himself discerned as executor dative, but me and my other brother don't believe he's a fit and proper person. And I'll say, well, why do you take that view? He's your brother. Well, he's not been in contact with the family for 30 years and he's been in jail 4 times for crimes of dishonesty. We don't think he is the person to wind up mum's estate. And I have to say to them that there's nothing I can do about that. The best I can do, because if confirmation has been issued, it's a very much different state of affairs. If confirmation hasn't been issued, I could put in a petition for recall of the appointment of the older bad brother. But the sheriff has no discretion in the matter, and what he will do is, where he sees that my client is upspilt about the thing, he'll appoint them both. He'll say, right, you're both executors dative, and if they don't get on, that's a recipe for a disaster. So I support this as a quick fix on the basis that I would like to see more debate about the powers of sheriffs and whether or not bonds of cation should be retained in connection with the second Succession Scotland Bill, which is obviously going to have to be enacted.
Have you anything you wish to add, Nobody?
I mean, my only thought is, a long time ago, as a law student, you got told that delegated powers were not the best way of making good law. That's what I carry through life. But so, I don't know what the current view on that matter is. It's a different house.
I'm certain we could probably spend the whole of the rest of the day discussing whether or not that is currently a good idea or not, or indeed fashionable currently.
I think I would agree with that as well. I think that's probably still the view that would be taken, that it would be better for the Parliament to make a decision that was in primary legislation, and particularly in succession law, which affects everybody. It's the area of law that most affects the general public. Everybody has experience of death, and I think it's undesirable for there to be, well, it's desirable for there to be as little discretion as possible within the operation of succession law. I think if the rules are clear and certain, then people know where they are, and particularly in the aftermath of a bereavement, you want that certainty within the law.
And indeed accessibility.
And accessibility, yeah.
And therefore, if it's in the primary legislation, it's much easier for particularly beneficiaries of small estates. Thank you. That's all I have to say.
I think that probably takes us to the area that Lesley Brennan was hoping to explore, actually, wasn't it?
Thank you. Can I ask, do you think it would have been possible to forgo pursuing this issue until a further succession bill was brought forward next session?
Well, I think if you were the family of somebody who died with a small estate in the next few months, you would find that at the rate that succession bills go through any parliament, you might be waiting 30 years before you didn't need to employ a lawyer to get the bond of cation. I exaggerate, but this gives a quick remedy that's appropriate and you know, for that, I would welcome it.
Yes, I think maybe those of us who've been waiting for a succession bill for a long time think that it may not happen quickly, and therefore a temporary solution probably is needed.
Okay, because of the market failure, because of the obviously
because of the cost of lawyers.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Can I ask the next one is: do you think there would have been benefit in further consultation on this matter?
Oh, well, maybe it would be nice if Zurich had given us a year's warning and that would have allowed proper consultation, but given where everybody is, I think it has to be done. And what's proposed is fine. Yeah.
I agree. I think in the circumstances, as I said, it's a quick fix, but I think it's proportionate and fair.
Okay.
I mean, it certainly would be to be hoped that when the main succession bill comes along, the delegated powers aspect of this could be revisited at that point.
Okay, thank you.
I think you'd be quite clear that this committee would endorse that view, that we would rather have appropriate detail on the face of any bill. I mean, that is one of the drums that we have banged in this session. Clearly, it won't be my committee now, but I suspect our successor committee would feel roughly the same. But of course, it's always about an appropriate balance, and sometimes when time is not on your side, the balance is very definitely to get it in delegated powers. John Mason, I think, wants to continue.
Yes, thanks, convener. I mean, I think especially Dr. Reid, you suggested that a lot of people, the general public and beneficiaries, may not be aware of what the rights are and what the processes are and all of this kind of thing. I mean, is this going to complicate it further? Are beneficiaries do they know nothing, so it doesn't really matter? Or is it going to confuse things for beneficiaries as to there's no bondication, where do they go, how do they get their rights, that kind of thing?
I think there really is an enormous public ignorance about succession law and how it operates. And most people probably find out from a website when someone dies what they need to do and are very much under the guidance of the court. Mm. I suspect that won't be any change.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's a matter of choice whether or not you instruct a solicitor. And if my memory serves me, I think there is something in the wee leaflet, what to do after death or what to do when someone dies, that does direct people to solicitors if they feel that they need legal advice. So, I mean, to take legal advice or not to take legal advice is the personal choice of an individual. But it's always there and available.
Okay. Right. Thank you. I mean, previously, as we heard, the government had decided to postpone legislation on bondsification because there was this question, as I think you said yourself, Mr. Kerrigan, that what other protections should be in place. And, you know, from Trustbar, we have specific suggestions as to what could be stated. For example, people who have unspent convictions for crimes or offences of dishonesty should not be executor's dative. I mean, should more of that be on the face of the bill? Could that have been put into the face of the bill rather than giving ministers so much discretion?
I think that's a more complex question, which is tied up with the second consultation document, which was published in June. The consultation document, which was published in August 2014, the bill is a reaction to that document and the responses received. The Scottish Government raised the question of bondsification and whether sheriffs should be given discretion to refuse to appoint in the first consultation document, but because of the wide-ranging nature of the responses, they decided, I think quite appropriately, they should reconsult on it. And that's what I understand is happening now. Now, the June 2015 consultation is now closed, but we're waiting to hear what the responses were and how the Scottish Government's going to react. So I think this more substantive law would be for the next Succession Scotland Bill, based on the government's assessment of the responses to the June 2015 consultation.
So we put this, if we've put this legislation through just now, that would give quite wide discretion, but then hopefully that would be revisited when we look at another succession law. That you're comfortable with that process?
Well, I don't think what's proposed at the moment gives a sheriff discretion.
I was thinking more gave ministers more discretion.
Oh, yes, sorry. Yes, sorry. Yes, no, yes sorry. I apologise.
No, I didn't put that very well, perhaps. Are other folk happy with that as well?
I mean, I think there are two sides of providing protection. One is the discretion about the executor, which some of this focuses on, and the other side of it is the protection in the division of the estate. Both are a form of protection. I mean, it would be possible to put them into this bill, but possibly it would be done in too much haste, depending on, given the late stage that the bill is at. Yeah. It would probably be desirable to put it into the next succession bill, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I think as a committee, we don't like very wide powers for ministers, yeah. But I think what you're basically saying is, given the speed of this, it's better to go down that route and then look at the specifics later on. Is that that's kind of what you're saying? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I ask the very specific question that I did actually put to the officials? Am I right in thinking that this does represent a slight increase in the risk of fraud, but there is a compensating reduction in total costs?
I suppose the answer is it's a theoretical increase. There's a theoretical opportunity for fraud.
Yeah.
There is always an opportunity for fraud. In cases where I've had bondification, in the course of the discussions with the client, we've discovered unknown family members who had a right on the succession. Now, you don't get that if you have to do a family tree with an independent person overviewing it. As long as the person is Scottish-born and bred and their ancestors are Scottish-born and bred, but I hesitate to know what the situation would be with the people that are arriving as refugees just now, how mm-hmm. you would trace them. And the evidence is that people that come like that in the past have done very well within one generation. And their family tree can be extremely complex to work out. So, you win and you lose. It's maybe a reason for everybody having a will.
I don't think we've ever disputed that everybody should have a will, and yes, I think it's been suggested that, as well as the document that tells you what to do after a death, there should be a document that tells you what to do before death.
Yes.
And that would make much of this redundant. Yes. Thank you. I think final comments are coming from Stuart.
Please. Be relatively brief, convener. I will make the observation, as someone who has a certificate in a genealogy, paleographography and heraldic studies, that those who are easiest to do family trees for are the aristocracy and criminals. So I merely make that as an observation. Their lives are better documented than others. Let's merely
take your own family tree.
38 generations.
Thank you.
but let's return to the immediate issue. I think John Kerrigan made an interesting point when he said the decision should be for an individual as to whether they take legal advice or not. But in the circumstances in which we find ourselves here, a commercial company outside the legal system appears to be depriving people in certain circumstances of that particular choice. And in that case, should the legislation that we're contemplating now, as an alternative to what's before us, give the courts the discretion as to whether a bondification should be required by assessing the circumstances as they see them? And that's often a useful way of dealing with other things in the legal system.
I think the Scottish Court Service said it was 800 small estates.
Yeah.
I'm a great believer in fairness across the board. And I would say that I think the risk of serious fraud is small. And I'm comfortable with this. But I could see an argument as to why at this stage a sheriff might be given discretion. But again, I think that might be complicating matters unduly. That's probably a decision for the wider discussion in respect of the next bill.
I think there's something that's completely omitted from our discussions on this, and that is that depending how your estate is spread, it may not actually be necessary for people with estates around the small estate to actually need confirmation, because most of the UK high street banks will actually allow the money in the bank account to be handed out to somebody who appears as being the heir without anything more than them signing some sort of indemnity, and usually without any special insurance charge being taken. So that if you're fortunate enough to have £10,000 in, say, Lloyd's TSB or whatever it's trading as just now, then you'll get that money out. But if you have your money in shares in Lloyd's banking group, then you need confirmation in order to be able to sell the shares. And that seems to me to be, you know, quite odd. And if you can get the money out without confirmation, then a lot of our concerns should be applying to that as well.
But is it correct, however, to say that while the possession of the money may be achieved by the process that the bank undertakes, the legal entitlement to that money, which is now in your possession, remains pending until confirmation has taken place? Is that a reasonable statement for a layperson to
make? That's a technically accurate. If you don't have confirmation, you're classed as something that's called a vicious intromitter in Scotland. Now, it's all in the textbook, but it's never actually, I've never actually seen it other than threatened at people. It sounds really nasty. The reality is that you get the money and then you pay it out to the people that you think are the heirs, and the people that think they are the heirs can come and hassle you for the money if they know the bank account exists. But I'm sure there's lots of estates that never go near the confirmation process because it's all in small bank accounts.
So just to be clear then, it is possible to wind up a small estate without any process of confirmation. That is a legally permissible.
It's legally possible.
Possible, yes.
But I'm also hearing the suggestion that it's not uncommon.
In small estates, it is not uncommon.
Now, in the definition of small estates you're using in this context, is that the same as the definition we're dealing with in the context of the legislation?
Each banking organisation and insurance company has different rules that apply to their assets. So a lot of them are £20,000 or under. So if you had one bank account in that category, you would be within the small estates definition. Sometimes they also require you to say what's the total estate. Sometimes they don't. And these forms seem to change from time to time.
Yeah. Sometimes insurance companies will ask you to give details of the family.
So that I think they can check that if they give the money to you, they have some assurance that you will pay out the money to those in the family who are entitled to it. I mean, your point's an entirely fair one. It is possible to take command of a small estate without confirmation. There's a difference between who's entitled to those funds and who can take command of them. And you're then relying on the person who takes command, the good big brother, who says, my two younger sisters are entitled to a third of this each. Not the baddie that I mentioned to you earlier, who's likely to go off to Tenerife for 6 months and then come back and say the money's gone.
Do forgive me, and remember I'm a lay person, so my question may be hopelessly naive. I'm now in a position of uncertainty as to, in law, when confirmation is actually required in the process of winding up an estate. Oh. Is there a concise and accessible explanation of when it is required?
So to that is that in theory you should get confirmation on all occasions, but the reality is that if the deceased had their money in the right things at the right time, then you can engather the estate without actually having to get confirmation.
But you carry, sorry, do forgive me, I just want to be absolutely as clear as it's possible for me to be, but therefore you will retain indefinitely the risk that in the absence of confirmation, what you've done could be challenged.
That's correct.
Right. Okay. Sorry, Dr.
No
Root.
One knows enough to challenge. That's the truth. Yes. And I think a lot of succession law, I repeat the point, is operating under the radar. And out with the confirmation process completely. And I made a Freedom of Information request to the Statistical Division of the Scottish Courts Service, who record, and also HMRC actually, because the figures that are recorded in relation to estates are confirmed estates in Scotland. And those confirmed estates, you can get information on, you know, small estates, what proportion small estates are of those confirmed estates. But when you actually look at the number of deaths in the country, the recorded confirmed estates is a tiny proportion of the number of deaths. So in discussion with the Statistical Division, we worked out a rough estimate. Probably half of all deaths in Scotland are not confirmed.
I think, convener, if anything, we have merely confirmed that academics are in the business of giving us questions as much as they are as giving us answers. I'm absolutely fascinated by where we've got to, but I think we've covered everything else I might reason.
Yeah, indeed. Thank you. Can I just... Thank you. I think you have, and I'm delighted that academics come along here and give us questions. I mean, I think that's absolutely part of the process, so that's no criticism at all. Can I just ask whether you feel there's any alternative way of getting some kind of scrutiny of who is given the power of an executive? Is there some other... Is there an alternative scrutiny method that would actually allow a sheriff to get the right kind of information, assuming he's got a discretion? Are we missing something in the system whereby somebody could say that's a good idea or not?
At the present moment, there's no requirement for intimation of the petition for the appointment of an executor on right. anybody with either a prior claim on the estate or an equal ranking claim on the estate. And that might be something that could be looked at. It's something that would have, a small cost implication to yep. the court service, because they'd need to check that everybody had received intimation, but it would primarily be a responsibility on the applicant, the petitioner, to be executor. But it wouldn't be unduly burdensome. It's a letter sent.
Right. So if I've understood you correctly... that would be along the lines of, I want to present myself to be the executive dative. I know I've got three brothers and a couple of grandchildren, and I need to tell the court that I have actually written to those other people, telling them that I'm putting myself in this position, so they've got an opportunity to disagree with me.
Yeah, we could put into more legalese, but that's
yes.
fine.
Yeah, I'm not good at legalese, I'm afraid. Right, okay. In which case, I'm wondering whether I could just pick up on what I think I've heard you suggest, and then one further question. What I think I've heard you suggest is that there might be a greater involvement of the sheriff clerk in what goes on, and that they might not just be the first port of call who hands out the bits of paper and advice, but I think I've heard you suggest that they might be in a position to provide some advice on who the heirs might be.
I think they already... are involved in the process in helping, and below a certain value, they're already involved in helping people to manage the process, the inventory and the confirmation process. And I think the suggestion of a family tree being included in that, and then it would be then very easy to say, this is the estate, this is the family tree, therefore, there are very concrete rules, therefore, on the basis of those two documents, here's who it should go to.
And that would be providing technical advice essentially from a court official?
It would be providing some level of supervision, which I think, in my view, succession law is crying out for.
Right. Well, I guess what I'm trying to explore is whether you feel that would represent an increase in the duties of the court.
It's a question not for us, but I fear any increase in workload would be noticeable. And it, because the commissary process just now in some courts is not running quickly.
Yes.
Yeah, can I rephrase, forgive me, can I rephrase the question? I accept it's more work. Mm-hmm. That wouldn't be, I think, a dispute. I was just wondering whether it constituted an increase in the duties of the court, or presumably not the powers of the court, but are we putting a duty on the court in the person of the clerk to do something that they're not currently duty bound to do?
Yes.
And that would bring a workload.
There are some commissary clerks who are very good and who do give, when somebody turns up with a small estate, which obviously qualifies within the small estate procedure, they give the people who turn up, the lay people, very good advice.
Yeah.
So they're doing that already without having necessarily a duty to do so.
Yeah.
It's not a duty, but there is certainly the information that's available to the public is the sheriff clerk will help you with this below a certain value. So it would be not a duty, but part of that process of assistance. It may require some additional training for sheriff clerks, but it's not terribly complicated. And actually what it would also allow is if that paperwork was in place, which doesn't need to be terribly onerous, it allows the sheriff to see that information when confirmation is being granted.
Yeah.
So I suppose the duty is on the sheriff rather than on the sheriff clerk.
Yes, with you. John?
Just developing that theme then, if this was to become a duty of a service offered by sheriff clerks, who would be a responsibility where, notwithstanding the best of intentions, poor advice to be given in such circumstances?
Perhaps the government should invest in an app that could quite easily be programmed, I think.
Really?
Yes.
And then it would be up to the individual themselves to make the decisions rather than rely on the advice of a sheriff clerk.
There is always the backstop.
I'm just looking at liability, because that's what Bones of Cation about were about, obviously, in the first place. We've kind of strayed off that, but...
But it always has to go before the sheriff.
My understanding, never having been a sheriff clerk and never having been a sheriff, my understanding is that if there is a case the sheriff clerk is uncomfortable about, they will actually discuss it with the sheriff that does commissary work routinely, without us being told that. And
I see.
That should presumably apply to lay applicants as well.
Right, thanks so much.
One point I would make, if a lawyer is negligent in the winding up of an intestate estate, that is not of itself grounds for vacation or paying out. The beneficiaries have a claim against the lawyer. The cationers will say that's nothing to do with us. A bond of cation is an indemnity guarantee, and cationers, I have heard, if they've had to pay out because the executor has done something silly, the first thing they do is they exercise what is known as the right of relief, and they go against the executor to recover what they've paid out. But they don't go against the solicitors for professional negligence. That's covered by a different policy.
Can I think that probably has concluded everything that we wanted to ask, possibly not everything that our experts wanted to say, because it might be that you have some thoughts about drafting, please. I don't know who wants to lead on that.
I've got a couple of thoughts, not to change anything really beyond the word order. In clause 5.3b.
Let's just give everybody the opportunity to find, including me. Clause 5.3b.
It reads presently, regulations under this section may make provision in relation to b, appointments of persons as executor dative of particular descriptions. I think it should be appoint persons of particular descriptions as executors dative. But that's on the basis that it would be removing people that had the criminal convictions from being executors dative. You don't get an executor dative qua criminal.
I'm with you. Thank you. I'm sure that's noted by those who hold the red pen.
I had great problems reading clause 2.2, which was best legal mumbo jumbo. It reads as, at present moment, as well as in relation to applications under Section 3 of the Small Intestate Estates Act made after this section comes into force, the amendments made by subsection 1 apply in relation to applications under that section of that Act made before this section comes into force, which are not by then determined.
Yes.
The simple alteration would be where it, at the end, where it says comes into force, which are not by then determined, if it was changed to came into force, which were not by then determined. That would help enormously. I have a more substantive improvement, which I can see reasons for not doing, and that subsection 2 should read, the amendments made by subsection 1 apply in relation to applications under section 3 of the Small Intestate Estates Act made after this section comes into force, and to those made before this section came into force, which were not by then determined.
Yes.
So that I can let you have that in writing.
I was going to say, I think if you could give us a copy of those, and indeed the government a copy of those, folk might want to reflect on whether that's something that they feel is significant. Can I say I'm very grateful to you for your thoughts on that, because these are the kind of things that can be important.
Just to make sure, once again, this layperson understands what's being said, are you suggesting that the process should be changed after the process has started, but before it's completed?
What
is that the essence of what you're saying?
I'm trying to make it easier to read legislation. I'm not trying to change what's proposed. What's proposed is that in the future, once this is law, there's no need to get bonds of cation where you go to the sheriff clerk. But there will be cases between this becoming an act where, with the timing of things, if somebody goes the day after the act or the day before the act is passed, you've probably missed the point that you can get a bond of cation from Zurich. If you've missed the bond of cation from Zurich, you've got to go to Royal Sun Alliance. Royal Sun Alliance says, got to hire a lawyer. If you hire a lawyer, you're talking about probably £1,000 of extra costs. Mm-hmm. So in order to get round forcing that, this proposal, the bill as drafted, is saying in that little period, if you just wait until this becomes an act, the sheriff clerk will not require you to have cation. But technically, you made the application under the old law, when the old law applied, so therefore technically you should have cation. And it's saying for these people, we want it to slide under the new rules, although technically we would be entitled to insist on cation, but we know that's going to cost you extra money. So we're saying this small group of people don't need to get cation.
I think what I'm hearing is a plea for retrospection,
that's
which is not something we as legislators leap at with any great willingness.
Well, the retrospective aspect of it is actually in the draft bill.
Right. Okay.
And if you're trying to ensure that the minimum costs are met by this group of usually relatively poor people, you've got to go along with it on this case. And it's only a little narrow window. Mm-hmm. And there's probably only about 10 cases. I don't know.
And we might argue it's not retrospection. We might argue it's transitional, actually, because we're doing it now and it's for the future, but before we get to the next gate.
Yes.
Right. Thank you. Thank you for those suggestions. Can I ask, Clancy, if you've anything else that you'd like to put on the record? It's wonderfully good to see you here. No, it looks as though we're done. I think colleagues are done, in which case I'm very grateful. And again, I'll suspend this meeting for a while. Thank you very much indeed. Right, thank you very much indeed. Right, resuming, it's my pleasure to welcome Paul Wheelhouse, MSP, the Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, supported by Jill Clark and Neil Moji. Minister, do you want to make any kind of statement on the basis of what you've just heard, please, before we go to questions?
If I may, Convener, yes, please. I apologise in advance, it's a reasonably lengthy one, but hopefully it will put a number of things on the record and that will help the committee.
Yep.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for inviting me here today to talk about the bonds of occasion. I appreciate the committee will have questions about the amendments we have lodged, but I thought it might be helpful to take a little time to set out some background to our proposal. Some of what I'm going to say was set out in my letter of 14th January to the committee, but I'm sure it will be helpful to place our approach on the record. My officials have also provided the committee with a detailed note on the issues around bonds of occasion. The Scottish Law Commission recommended that the statutory requirement placed on executors' datives, those appointed by the court usually because there is no will to administer an estate, to obtain a bond of cation should be abolished. A bond of cation is an insurance policy that protects the beneficiaries and creditors from loss caused by maladministration, as we've just been hearing, negligence or indeed fraud. The Scottish Law Commission made this recommendation on the basis of the financial and administrative burden these provisions create and the current difficulties which exist in obtaining bonds of cation, the cost, the limited number of providers, delays in issuing cation and the conditions which providers sometimes attach to the bond. We consulted on the abolition of bonds of cation along with the other provisions which are in this bill. There was support for the abolition, but it was clear that some alternative safeguards would be needed, at least in some circumstances, so we indicated that we would not abolish bonds of cation without further consultation on the safeguards. There are currently only two providers of bonds of cation for executory purposes, and they are Zurich and Royal Sun Alliance, as we've been hearing. Zurich has taken a business decision to withdraw from this market with effect from the 1st of February 2016. The sole provider with effect from 1st of February 2016, Royal Sun Alliance, has a requirement that provision of a bond of cation is a conditional on a solicitor being appointed to administer the estate. Zurich did not have such a requirement. The decision by Zurich was not anticipated, and in real terms the period of notice is very short. We were alerted to Zurich's decision by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, who were concerned about the impact, especially for small estates. Currently, estates with a total gross value of less than £36,000 are classed as small. This threshold is subject to change from time to time. An executor of a small estate may in certain cases employ a solicitor to get confirmation or obtain confirmation without a solicitor. In the case of the latter, there are simplified procedures in place and the Sheriff Clerk is able to assist, as we have heard. Those who choose to seek confirmation without a solicitor avoid paying legal fees, which have the potential to drain a small estate, and a separate case has therefore already been made for them. We have therefore had to act quickly and consider whether something needed to be done now, and if so, what would be the best solution. We agreed that the impact of small estates is concerning, and the obligation to instruct a solicitor in these circumstances could be a significant burden which has the potential to severely diminish and in some cases even drain a small estate. For others, the impact could create real hardship. For example, a widow dies perhaps without leaving a will. She leaves a 19-year-old daughter who's in tertiary education. They live in rented accommodation and her estate is valued at £10,000. The mother has been saving over the years so that her daughter could go to university and has been using her savings to fund her daughter's living and associated expenses. The daughter will need all of the £10,000 to complete her education. The obligation to instruct a solicitor and the corresponding fees will mean that the daughter cannot afford to complete her education, and all at a difficult time, as we've heard, when she's coming to terms with the loss of her mother. Given the regrettable and somewhat precipitate withdrawal of Zurich, we consider that it would be appropriate to exempt these small estates from the requirement to obtain a bond of cation. In these cases, preserving as much of the estate as possible will make a real difference to the beneficiaries. The amendments we propose therefore focus on a small estate which is subject to the simplified procedure. There is already a filtering mechanism in the court which means that if a small estate is contentious, then it does not qualify for the simplified procedure. The flip side of the coin is if the circumstances that a bond of cation would indemnify could still occur. An executor dative could distribute the estate incorrectly and a beneficiary loses out. Instead of that beneficiary being recompensed by the bond of cation, they would instead have to make a claim against the executor. If the executor has benefited from their maladministration, then they should have the necessary assets to pay any damages due to the beneficiary. A beneficiary may qualify for legal aid depending on their income. If their loss is less than £3,000, they could raise a small claims action, which is a procedure which has been designed so that a solicitor is not required and costs are kept to a minimum. Already in some small estates, fund holders pay out without the need for confirmation. The threshold varies depending on the fund holder. And in those cases, there will therefore have been no bondification in place, and we're not aware that this creates problems. There are also currently few calls on bondification, and if, for example, in the instance I outlined above, where perhaps there was both a surviving son and a daughter, and the son was estranged, if the son applied to be the executor dative with the aim of taking the full benefit of the estate, it is likely that in these circumstances the daughter would also apply, and because they were competing executors, the estate would not qualify for the simplified procedure and there would be a requirement for a bondification and solicitor to be involved. That is probably the right outcome in these circumstances to ensure that the estate is distributed properly. We've had to balance the impact of small estates with the need to protect beneficiaries, but we consider that in all of the circumstances, our proposal is proportionate and targets only the most vulnerable estates, which are small in size and are uncontentious, and therefore there is far less likely to be a concern about the distribution of the estate. One provider in itself is also undesirable, and whilst the remaining provider has given us assurances that it has no intention of withdrawing from the market, we are not able to say what business decisions the remaining provider may make in the future. We therefore need a solution to deal with the possibility of the remaining provider, Royal Sun Alliance, withdrawing. Otherwise, we will be in the position where a bondification is required as a matter of law before confirmation can be granted, but there is no ability to obtain that bondification. That is why we are also proposing to take powers in relation to the abolition of cation and the powers of court in relation to the appointment of an executor dative. The future landscape is uncertain, and we need to potentially deal with a range of matters, but I did hear the concerns more generally about the use of delegated powers in this circumstance. We're therefore proposing a power, though, in this situation for Scottish ministers to set out further circumstances in which cation should not be required to be found, including a power to abolish the requirement for cation altogether. We're also proposing a power for ministers to be able to make regulations that set out conditions that must be satisfied or information that must be provided before the court appoints an executor dative. We're also proposing a power that could require the courts to be satisfied that a person is suitable for appointment as executor dative. The intention would be not to use the powers unless the remaining provider withdraws. Alternatively, the powers could be used to reflect the outcome of further consultation on the issues which were identified by us as needing to be explored before bondification were abolished. Finally, the regulations could be used to deal with any issues that arise in relation to the abolition of cation for small estates. The committee will no doubt be looking at these in the context of their delegated powers role. We also propose that the amendment should come into force immediately after royal assent to minimise any delays in confirmation that might be caused by Zurich's withdrawal. The abolition of the requirement of cation will apply in relation to any applications for cation which have not been determined before the amendments come into force. SCTS has assured us that the small gap between the withdrawal of Zurich and the coming into force of the amendments can be managed by them administratively. I would finally like to say something about the fact that the committee is having to turn its mind to a topic which has not featured in the bill to date and which amends the bill in a different way to the SLC bill. I'm entirely sympathetic with the view that this is an undesirable position to be in, and I can very much appreciate why the committee are taking evidence today, and this is not a situation I would envisage occurring even on an irregular basis in the context of the Scottish Law Commission bill procedure. The situation is not one of our making, but given the concerns about the impact of Zurich's decision, it would have been remiss of the Scottish Government not to act quickly and do what it could to try and remedy the position. Doing nothing would, and place a new and unwelcome burden on small, uncontentious estates, leave the market further exposed should Royal Sun Alliance also withdraw, create a position where there could potentially be a situation where a legal requirement was incapable of being met, resulting in estates being incapable of being wound up. Any delay in acting also impacts adversely on the public and also the operational ability of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. So I'm sure the committee will agree that these outcomes are undesirable. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Colleagues obviously want to ask questions. I'm wondering if I could just start, though, by picking up on the, first of all, on the point you made about it coming in, bringing in something that wasn't in the original bill. I think we entirely understand why that is the case. We do recognise that probably that couldn't have been in the bill as introduced, but nobody seems to have any trouble introducing it later, which is an interesting quirk of the process. But that's absolutely fine, and I think we entirely understand that would be the case. Could I just pick up, though, on the issue of a sole insurer, without wishing to cast any aspersions, a sole provider is obviously an economic advantage. It was suggested earlier that the government might provide some kind of insurance. It was also suggested, I think, that maybe the government was not in a position to do that, whereas the Westminster government might be. I'm wondering whether you can address that issue, please, Minister.
Well, I think it's an important point. I mean, I understand that this point was made earlier on. The current legal requirements are to be financially regulated would discount the Scottish government from providing cation. many considerations such as state aid, because of the impact of commercial market tests and because of the impact of commercial markets and obvious financial budget implications as well. The Scottish Government would also be involving themselves in what is essentially a private matter, and we're not sure that that would be appropriate or desirable from the government's point of view, but I do hear the point that was made earlier on, but I think the more fundamental thing is that the Scottish Government isn't regulated by the Financial Services Authority and therefore wouldn't be able to actually provide the service.
It's what I'd expected. I'm grateful for your advice. Can I bring in Stuart first? I think
I just wanted to pick up and make sure we're not putting on the record something that might be misrepresenting the case. Early in the Minister's remarks, he talked about the case where an executor does not employ a solicitor, and that would, and I think I'm quoting correctly, avoid paying legal fees. I just wanted to be clear, was that simply referring to avoid paying legal costs associated with employing a solicitor, but there might still be fees associated with the confirmation process before the court. So just for clarification, it doesn't relieve the fees that the court might apply.
That is correct. Mr. Stevenson is quite correct. We're referring to the cost of employing a solicitor rather than any fees associated with...
So the word costs would be better than fees.
Indeed, that's quite,
fine.
Quite correct.
That's all I wanted to do.
John Scott?
Thank you. Forgive my naivety. So the proposal put forward by Dr. Reid is not something that you would be in favour of, because the courts, essentially the government, is that what you're saying, and therefore you wouldn't be encouraging sheriff clerks to provide, well, not to be any providers, where both Zurich and Royal and Sun Alliance to withdraw. Dr. Reid's proposal wouldn't be one that would find favour with you. Is that correct?
Unfortunately, Mr. Scott, I wasn't here during the discussion by Dr. Reid in terms of this point. However, I mean, I understood it was a reference to the Scottish Government becoming an insurer effectively, and so that's the perspective I've taken rather than courts and tribunal service. I think a similar issue would arise for SCTS and not being financially regulated, but I can ask perhaps my colleague Jo Clark to comment on that, if it may.
Perhaps she would, because she had the evidence.
We are talking about the public sector stepping in as...
The Sheriff Clark, so that would essentially be a function of government, yes.
Yes.
So that would not be a solution that would find favour with you.
Not for the reasons the minister said.
Right, thank you. The main question I wanted to ask was really, have you received any adverse comment from any source whatsoever about these proposed amendments, albeit they've only been in the public domain for a very short time, or they may not even be in the public domain yet?
Well, with the exception of the comment that was made regarding the drafting of one of the clauses there, we haven't had any negative feedback. I believe we've had positive feedback from Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service and the Law Society in terms of key consultees, and not aware of any objections having been lodged to the Government at this point in time, but I've just confirmed that with Jo Clark.
We're aware that Trustbar have submitted a memorandum and they would like us to go further with in terms of discretion, but we've not had any negative reaction.
And how do you view the Trustbar comments to develop the discretionary element for the sheriff?
Well, I certainly note that the debate that I just witnessed in regards to the second succession bill, and clearly there's more fundamental reform that could be undertaken at that point. I think Mr. Kerrigan fairly described this as a quick fix, albeit I think he was very positive in his remarks about it being a proportionate one. But if we had considered that this change to law was possible without the further consultation we've undertaken, the bill would have been introduced with such a provision. And that was not the case. However, there was no consensus around the detail of this issue, and the resource impact too needed much more investigation. And should we make provision for this in the future, it will be on the basis of the outcome of the further consultation we've carried out, which we've yet to report back on, and further discussion of the key stakeholders who may be impacted. And it's also worth remembering that this proposed change relates to the wider issue of abolishing bonds of cation for everyone, and not to the narrow remedy we're making for these amendments to fix a particular situation that has arisen following withdrawal of Zurich. So it wasn't the clearest cut area in terms of the consultation we've had to date, and clearly we needed to engage with stakeholders further on what proposals we can take forward as to the more fundamental reforms around bondsification, and we can do that through the second succession bill should that come forward.
Lesley Brennan, please.
Thanks. I just wanted to come back on the point that you've been asked twice about obviously the situation where we are now with Zurich withdrawing on the 1st of February, and we're only having one provider, which obviously is a market failure, and you would hope in the situation when there's a market failure that the government would step forward. And we've heard that the level of risk seems to be really pretty small. You've got 800 cases of small estates. And we've heard from the experts that very few people actually make any sort of claims against the bonds of education currently. So if there was scope to change the current regulations to make the Scottish Government then the insurer almost of last resort in this case, but given the level of risk, the amount that you're exposing is such a small amount, because obviously that market doesn't exist in the rest of the UK. I just wonder, is there not a case for a Scottish solution? Because what Dr. Dot Reid, the prescription issue is outlining, seems really pretty sensible that the sheriff clerk would put in a wee model there that with pretty low risk.
Well, certainly the point, I mean, I understand the point has been made, but I think there's a couple of issues. Firstly, as I said in my earlier remarks, there's a fundamental issue that we are not allowed to provide insurance products as we're not financially regulated by the Financial Services Authority, and we don't have legislative competence in this Parliament to legislate on such matters. So, any such changes would have to take place within the UK Parliament. There's also the secondary issue that we'd be involving ourselves in a private matter. I'm not sure that would necessarily be appropriate for Scottish Government in that circumstance. I mean, I'm happy to look at what was said earlier on by Dot Reid, but in terms of her evidence, and obviously not having seen that, I can't comment on the detail of what she said. But I think those are two key barriers that we need to have a look at whether they could be overcome. Certainly, the first one is the most fundamental one, that we currently cannot provide insurance as we are not regulated by the Financial Services Authority within Scottish Government, so we're not legally able to offer insurance products.
Okay, thank you.
So,
I might have missed it, because you've mentioned Sheriff Clark a couple of times, and I didn't pick up what Dr. Reid had said in connection with the government stepping in, as a last resort insurer with a role for the Sheriff Clark. Could you explain what she did say? Because I've obviously missed it.
My understanding was that the estate would go to the Sheriff Clark, and they would draw the family tree. And where was the other bit about the
statement of distribution and the family tree?
So if there was any errors there, then I suppose the liability would rest then with the sheriff. Then would go to the Scottish Government, I suppose, is what was my interpretation. I don't know whether I'm correct in my understanding of it.
I think certainly there are possibilities in terms of improving the information that's available, and the Sheriff Clerk potentially having a role in looking at matters. That's, I suppose, a distinct matter from whether you're insured by a Scottish Government. It's a sort of secondary issue.
This was the root of my question to the previous panel about whether that generated a duty on the court to do something, because the duty comes with the responsibility to get it right, of course. If they merely had a power to provide advice, which manifestly they do, then that doesn't make them responsible necessarily for the advice that they give, which would appear to be the present situation. And I just wanted to explore with you whether you felt that we were in a perfectly sensible place at the moment, recognising that probably there isn't a duty to provide that information, and therefore there isn't actually a responsibility that covers the same as bondification.
So if I'm reading correctly, the responsibility for courts and tribunal service in the event that there was some form of maladministration they hadn't picked up. Yes, I can take the point. Clearly we are
trying to ensure that their risks are minimised, that there would be any maladministration or fraudulent activity, and the provisions we put in there about ensuring that the kinds of person that can be appointed as an executor dative will also help reduce that risk too. So there's a number of issues that we've done in our quick fix, if you like, to try and ensure that the risk of maladministration is reduced.
Right, okay. Thank you. I do have colleagues who want to come in. I'm just going to remind absolutely everybody we have only 20 minutes left. I'm told that in the context of land registration, there is a state indemnity scheme.
Is that right? I'm not aware of that, Camille. We can look into that and see if that is the case.
Well, that might be for all parties to ponder as we go along. Thank you very much. John?
Thank you. Yes, I mean, the general point has been made that there's quite wide powers given to ministers, and I think the suggestion has been that's a balance between the time speed that this needs to happen and thinking through all the details, because we had some specific suggestions from Trustbar, especially about executors, dative, and what might be excluded. Are you defending the kind of amount of powers that ministers have been given at the moment?
I'm slightly nervous, but I appreciate that it's far from ideal. I fully acknowledge that. We have to move quickly because of the timescales we have for completion of the bill itself. And I think it was a point fairly made by previous witnesses that a suitable legislative opportunity would be some way in the distance. So there is a danger that if we don't act now, we could find ourselves being put on the back foot if Royal Sun Alliance were to change their position from the one they've told us that they were perhaps a withdrawal from the market. We'd be in a very difficult position. So obviously there's the first step to try and provide a suitable solution for the small estates under £36,000, which we're doing, and I'm more comfortable about that. I think that is a very proportionate and sensible step to make. Obviously the second amendments really are regarding the additional powers to allow us to deal with at the time, should such a situation arise, Royal Sun Alliance were to withdraw. And I've absolutely no intention, nor ministerial colleagues have any intention of using that unless Royal Sun Alliance were to withdraw from the market and we were left in left high and dry. So it would allow us to move reasonably quickly rather than waiting for a subsequent primary legislative opportunity to do so.
Right. I mean, on that point, if you were to continue as minister in this position, obviously nobody knows what's going to happen.
Yes, there are a number of factors.
I mean, how high a priority would the next succession bill be? I mean, what kind, are we talking 2 years, 5 years, 10 years? Any idea?
Well, certainly it's not my gift to announce the government's legislative programme if we are re-elected, I would stress. But certainly we have given commitment to consult, which we have done on the Scottish Law Commission's more substantive proposals. We are obviously committed to reporting back on that consultation, and would intend to take forward any measures that we feel suitable to go forward with in the next Parliament. Beyond that, I'm afraid I'm not at liberty to really determine the schedule of bills in the next Parliament. Clearly, matter of an election to get through first.
Yeah, it could be some time ahead, in other words. And my final point then, Ailie Scobie gave some specific amendments, which I don't know if I haven't got my head around them, so I don't know if you have. But, I mean, have you any comments on that at all?
Well, we're happy to look at that. There's obviously a process issue to understand how we would maybe amend the amendments at stage three, perhaps a manuscript amendment or some other process would be required. But we're happy to look at that. I understand that Professor Scobie is going to provide the draft wording to yourselves and to the Scottish Government. So we'll have a look at that and see if it needs to be fixed.
Okay, thank you.
If the Scottish Government has approached Royal and Sun Alliance about their willingness or not to continue providing bonds of cash?
We have, yes. We have consulted them recently about their future plans in light of Zurich's decision, and they have confirmed they have no plans to withdraw from the market and will continue to provide bonds of cash, but will also continue to require a solicitor to be appointed as a condition of providing a bond. That's entirely their right to do so, of course. I'm not questioning that. We certainly have no reason to believe they will withdraw from the market. Clearly they have a clear field now in terms of being the only player in the market, but we would certainly try and continue to engage with them so that if their plans do change, that we're given as much notice as possible.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think there are a couple of other things that perhaps just worth putting on the record, though I'm not sure that really require a response. First of all, there was the suggestion that those who were seeking to become executive stative should be required to intimate that fact to any obvious alternative applicants. I'm wondering whether that might be put into the mix somewhere in thoughts about the future. And equally, I think there was a general point made about public understanding of the whole issue, which I think is absolutely fair, because I've got to say that I really knew very little about it until we got to having to look at it in this committee, and I'm quite sure that 99.9% of the population are in the same place.
Certainly on the latter point, I think I'm on record before as agreeing with the convener that, as you put it, what to do before death would be a good thing to do in terms of guidance to members of the public to ensure they are aware of how law of succession works and how they need to prepare for scenarios to look after the loved ones in the event of their death. So I think there is a general need to improve awareness of legal provisions for members of the public, and that cuts across a number of areas, but succession, as Dr. Reid said, is absolutely fundamental to us all, because at some point we're all touched by death, unfortunately, and therefore this law does have a profound impact on us all. In relation to the other point, I think that, if you remind me, convener, the point that was being made in relation to...
Intimation to beneficiaries. Yes.
Yes, I suppose in a theoretical sense that would be certainly attractive to ensure that there was a degree of communication between those who are affected by potentially being a role of executive dative. But in practice, as we heard from Mr. Kerrigan, there may be examples where estranged brothers, sisters, etc., may not talk to each other and may have absolutely no desire to collaborate with each other. I suppose it'd be if there was a requirement to do it rather than a nice to do, that might be might change matters. But it's there's a personal there's certainly a cost regarding that in terms of £40 to £60 per intimation, and we're looking at that as part of our wider consideration of the law of succession.
Okay, it sounds like an awfully expensive letter, but I'll take your advice on that. I think if I was the person who was writing those letters, I'd be feeling fairly rich. Right, I'm wondering on a happy note whether Stuart wants to... Yes, please.
In the Minister's introductory remarks, he said we'd only plan to exercise these powers under secondary legislation in the event of withdrawal of the final provider. Would he care to indicate that he would also consider using these powers if the conditions that final provider associates with the provisional bondification become, in the view of the government, unduly onerous?
That's a very fair point, I suppose. We've no indication, I should stress, that the Royal Sun Alliance will abuse their monopoly position. But should that arise, then I presume we would be in a position that we could do something about it with these powers. So that's a fair point. It's not what we're assuming, I should stress. I have no reason to believe that RSA will not act in an honourable way in this respect, but we do have the power, yes, to address that issue.
Indeed. Thank you. I think that indicates that everybody feels they've said everything they need to say. Do you want to add anything, Minister? Or do you?
Only just to reiterate the point, I regret the fact we're having to do this at this stage in the bill, but I'm very grateful for the committee's very short notice taking additional evidence to ensure that this issue is properly aired and scrutinised before coming before the chamber. So I appreciate the time and effort that's been put in by yourselves and your clerks and indeed the witnesses in coming forward today.
And thank you, and that gives me an opportunity to thank absolutely everybody involved for their efforts. And at that point, I move this meeting into private. Thank you.